podcast. I'm so glad that you're here with me. Okay, it's kind of a lazy day. If you're watching the video, you can see that I have no makeup on. I'm not properly dressed, but I wanted to make sure and share with you the message that I feel I need to share about finding your purpose. It's about influence. I want to talk about influence today. Who's influencing you? I want you to really think about that. Are you being influenced by influencers? I'm making air quotes on social media. Are you influenced by the television shows you watch? The videos you watch? Are you being influenced by music? By podcasts? By teachers? Books? Are you being influenced by people in your family? Close friends? Oh, maybe not so close friends or acquaintances. Are you being influenced by your boss, coworkers, neighbors? Are you under the influence of substances that alter your cognitive ability? Drugs, alcohol. I know it's not limited to that. There's so many things that people sniff and inhale and, you know, whatever. Anything that kills off brain cells. Are you under the influence of any of that? What about porn? Even exercise. You might think, exercise, what's wrong with exercise? Well, it can take over your life. If you're really, really into it, and let's say you want to compete and you're in the gym 6 hours every day, I would say that you're under the influence of the people who are helping you compete. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. But when anything becomes really important to you and it's something that you're giving a lot of your time to, then I think you have to look at the influence that it's having on you and decide, is that what you want? Is that what you choose? If so, that's fine. That's up to you. The last one on my list for influence that I think is worth exploring in our lives is ambition, the desire for success. I'm going to admit to you that's been probably throughout my life, that's been a common thread. The desire for success, worldly success, not real success. I thought money and having control over my life and a certain amount of power, I didn't want power over anybody else, but I wanted control over my life. I didn't want anybody else harming me. I didn't want to be vulnerable to anybody. So I equated that with, well, if I'm financially successful, if I own my own company, I'm not going to have a boss telling me what to do or a supervisor, coworkers telling me what to do. Actually, that I had some flaws in my thinking because owning my own business, every single one of my hundreds of clients could tell me what to do. So, but I was under the influence of the desire for success and the books that I read relative to gaining that success. So I read Success Magazine, every single issue from cover to cover, and I read everything by Zig Ziglar and Brian Tracy and Dr. Dennis Wheatley and Earl Nightingale and W. Clement Stone and Dr. Vincent Peale. I could go on and on. Napoleon Hill. I read all of that stuff. And I was under the influence of those people. It was actually, most of it was probably really good influence. It could have been a lot worse. But when I say under the influence, I'm talking about allowing the influence of someone or something to guide our thinking, which becomes our action, which informs and results in the reward or the consequence. right? It starts here. It starts in our minds. So going back to the top of the list, if you're being influenced by the culture, you're watching social media and you're being influenced by somebody in our current culture, and the message is maybe that you're only really having a great life if you're flying in private jets and driving in the back, riding in the back of Maybach cars or driving a Ferrari or whatever, I don't know, name it. If you're under the influence of that, for example, and you're the average person who does not fly on private jets and drive in Ferraris, well, then you're going to feel like you're less than, right? So the influence of culture typically, at the end of the day, makes us feel less than. The same is true with videos. For example, if we're watching videos of people who seem to have perfect bodies and they're, you know, they have the washboard abs and sculpted muscles, and then we look in the mirror and we don't look like that, we're going to feel badly about ourselves. Music. If we're listening to music with lyrics that talk about rape and murder and stealing and Grand Theft Auto and all these kinds of things, those things go in our head and get woven into the way that we think. If we're listening to things that talk about violence, for example, then violence and talk of violence can seem very normal to us. And that's not a good thing. We don't want to be under the influence of violence or theft or any other kind of crime. I included podcasts and teachers and books in there only because, if you're listening to, for example, if you're listening to a podcast every day and you're getting a steady stream of negativity, maybe it's of a particular political bent or whatever, but negative, you know, complaining or the anger, all of that's going in. It's going into your head. And you might not think it's influencing you. And you can say, she's crazy, and just turn me off. Don't do it. Don't turn me off. I'm going somewhere with this. But all of this is going in. It's going into your subconscious mind. It's going into shaping what you think is normal. Teachers or anybody who we're close to, we see on a regular basis, coworkers, bosses, friends, same kind of thing. If we're with people who we've allowed in close to us, they're going to have an influence on us. So we want to choose to allow people to be really close to us who are people of good character. I'm not suggesting that you never had any relationship with anybody who says or does things or has an attitude that is not exactly aligned with yours. We're never going to have anybody in our lives if we exclude people who don't think the way we think and feel the way we feel. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is we have to become aware when another person's belief system and values begin to permeate our thoughts and our feelings and become our belief system and values. And we have to decide if we're okay with that. The reason why I'm talking all about this is because it's so easy for that kind of influence to come in without us being aware of it. One example of this is I know someone who his boss converted to a religion that was not my friend's religion. And my friend and their whole family they went to church, they were involved in their church. And my friend heard from his boss over and over and over and over again, daily, about his new religion. And he was very enthusiastic about it. And he was very happy about the choice that he had made. And he just loved the people who he was around and, you know, all of that stuff. And the next thing you know, my friend, who had been lifelong in the Christian denomination that he was in, was now taking classes to learn about the other person's religion. And it really upset his family. Because then the classes became, I'm joining. I'm going to go do that. And he did. And so he would go off and do his worship in this other place. And the whole rest of his family would go off and worship where they had always worshiped. It was quite a divide in the family. Interestingly, when the boss was transferred, no longer worked there, it was as though the influence, the magic spell, the influence that my friend had been under lifted. He really no longer had this great desire to go worship in this other place, in this other religion. He wound up coming back and worshiping with his family. The rift was mended. But it was very interesting to me how someone outside of that family got in there and had enough influence to kind of create big division in the family. I'm glad it all worked out, but we see in a lot of situations where it's not a religion pulling the person away, it's a coworker who's sort of enticing the person away from their family. We've probably all known somebody who left their wife or left their husband, and in some cases their children, to go off with somebody else. For a coworker, a friend, a neighbor, to be able to have some kind of influence over someone, to get in under the protection, into the inner circle of a marriage, of a family, and break it up and pull one of those people out of that relationship, that is some serious influence. People I know who have had substance abuse disorders have told me stories about the first person who said, here, take this, it'll make you feel better. Or here, drink this, I'll make you a drink, it'll make you feel better. Oh, have another beer, it'll make you feel better. It's friends. It's somebody that you've let in behind the walls that guard your heart and mind and the quality of your life. And wow, the damage that can be done. The same with porn. I had porn on the list for a reason, because, you know, when you engage with that, you essentially are rewiring the way your brain thinks. You rewire what you want. And in any kind of fantasy, real life can't live up to it. Because in fantasy life, everything's perfect, right? Everyone's perfect. Everybody looks perfect. It sets up an influence so that what should then be attractive and beautiful to us is not. And that's really sad. So what's the answer to all this? Well, you know, I'm a Christian. I'm a person of faith. So I look to the Bible. I look to God's word for answers. And I'm not a theologian. I only know what I know. It's not very much. But I don't worry about the parts of the Bible that I really don't understand. I focus on what I do understand. And it's pretty clear what Jesus said. It's somewhere in the gospel. I couldn't quote chapter and verse, I think, if my life and soul depended on it. But, you know, nowadays with electronic Bibles, you can do a keyword search. And basically, it says that no one can say that Jesus is Lord unless they're under the influence of the Holy Spirit. And so I thought, oh, okay, well then, God's word is telling us whose influence we should be under. If we're praying and doing our best to believe, not only believing that there is a God, Satan, the ancient enemy, believes that there's a God. It's not about actually going to church and putting in time in the building, although it can be incredibly nurturing and all of that stuff. But it has to start with a relationship with God and asking the Holy Spirit to come into your life. This is what I do anyway, okay? I ask the Holy Spirit to lead me and guide me, to give me the right words and the right order, to lead me to the places that I'm supposed to be at exactly the time I'm supposed to be there in order to participate in whatever it is that God has for me on that day, really in that moment. That's how we live out God's plans for our lives, God's purpose for our lives, is it's moment by moment, really not even day by day. As a business person, I would love, love, love to have a 100-year plan. I'd love to have a 20-year plan, a 5-year plan, a 1-year plan. I would like to map it all out. I'd like to know exactly what God wants me to do on any given day at what specific time. But you know what? It doesn't work that way. It just doesn't, as much as I wish it would. God's purpose for our lives unfolds. And I think there are different life assignments throughout our lives, depending on the season that you happen to be in. But no matter where you are, whatever season you're in, whatever life assignment you're doing. So my example of what I mean when I say life assignment, so I owned my business and I protected and defended the good people and organizations that take care of abused children. I did that for many, many years, and I thought I would always do that. But it turns out that God had something else for me. I wrote my first book, and that turned into 15 books, and it's a different season. I'm just in a different season. And so when we go from one job to the next, it doesn't mean that we're outside of God's plan. It may very well mean that there's just a different season. But no matter where we are in any of that, the one thing that we can make sure about is that we're under the influence of God's own spirit. Not what the culture says, not what our family and friends and teachers and bosses and whoever else says necessarily, but really what God himself is saying to each of us. Now, that's not to say that we don't pay attention to all that stuff. Yeah, I watch the news. I'm on social media and all that. I'm not saying not pay attention and be aware. Just be very careful of the distinction between learning about something in order to understand it and actually allowing yourself to be under the influence of it. This is a big difference and distinction here. And it's something that we have to understand. It really goes back to guarding our hearts and our minds, being smart, being savvy, understanding what's going on in the world. I can understand something happening in the news. I don't know, for example, Russia invading Ukraine. I want to understand. I want to know. But I'm not going to put on a uniform and go fight. I'm not going to let it dominate my mind and my emotions and my actions to the point that I am so distracted by that that I'm not doing what I'm called to do. I hope this is making sense, because who you're influenced by will determine whether you find and live the good purpose for your life, or whether you spend your whole life outside of God's purpose for you. And that's a sad thing. I don't want that for anybody. That's why I do this podcast, because when you're outside of the purpose for which you were born and perfectly matched, and that scripture I do know, that's Ephesians 2:10, where God says that you are his masterpiece and you were created, you were born to do a work that was created specifically for you. See, there's a purpose for your life and you were matched to it. You have the personality for it. You have the character traits for it. You have the abilities for it. You know things that you just know. You didn't learn them in a classroom. You just know. Well, those things are for your purpose. Finding and doing that thing, that's the most important thing. So if you're under the influence of the Holy Spirit of God and you find yourself influenced by friends, pastors, bosses, whatever, who are leading you, supporting you, encouraging you in the direction of your purpose, fabulous, fabulous. But if not, and they would lead you away or off the path, distract you from God's purpose for your life, diminish your purpose, then you have to pull back. Then it's your responsibility to say, no, I don't feel peace about doing that. I don't want to do this or that or whatever it is that's the distraction. I'm not going to allow that anymore. And pray about it and ask for God's help. Ask God to remove the wrong people from your life if need be. Remove you from a situation. If it's a job, ask for a new job, you know, and then pay attention to opportunities that come your way. It sounds very simplistic to say, but it all boils down to, for me anyway, I pray and then I listen. Not for a booming voice out of heaven. I pay attention to what I hear, opportunities that come my way, emails, phone calls, whatever. God can get to you in all kinds of different ways. And then I act. It's very important that you act, because I've noticed that God will just not drop something right straight in our laps. We have to get up. We have to meet him on the path. Do our part. So I say we cooperate and we collaborate with God. But if you pray, listen, act, and then repeat that every day, you will be under the influence of God. And that's right where you need to be. I'm so glad that you joined me today. I hope you'll subscribe and share this and come back next week. See you soon.